Horman.
I mentioned last week that we're going to take advantage of the holiday, the upcoming holiday of Thanksgiving, to use some of our Sundays this month to focus on things for which we should be thankful. And it's not mere opportunism, taking advantage of the holiday just to have a catchy series of sermons. I do think it offers us a chance to reflect on a part of our identity as Christians. We have in the New Testament a number of places that remind us that thankfulness is to occupy a central and defining place in our identities as followers of Jesus. And so we're going to take some time to consider things that we should be thankful about, things that are part of our beliefs, our convictions about why we are to be thankful and rejoicing people. And this morning, we're going to pick up one more thing for which we should be thankful. We're going to take some time exploring why we should be thankful for God's unexpected and undeserved grace. We're going to do that by going through the story in Numbers chapter 1 through 21. Now, Numbers chapter 1 through 21 may not be in your top 10 list of memorable Bible stories. It may not be anywhere on your list of memorable Bible stories. But there's a really important pattern that I want us to pay attention to, and we'll do it in a very broad way, picking up major movements in that story, to illustrate one instance in Scripture of God's undeserved and unexpected grace. And we'll do that to illustrate that larger pattern that provides one of the reasons for the thankfulness that defines us as Christians. So before we do that, let's take a moment and pray together. Father, we are thankful that we can gather as a family this morning, thankful for all of the blessings that we have. We recognize that you've blessed us in more ways than we can count, and it's easy for us to take blessings that we enjoy for granted, to not recognize them as blessings, but to see them as features of our lives that are just there. Help us to cultivate a thankfulness that attributes all of the good things that we enjoy in life to your benevolent character. And we pray that you help us to have that same benevolence to people around us as we enjoy blessings from you, that they will enjoy blessings from us. Help us to be more like you. And we pray this through your Son. Amen. So, Numbers, if you've got a Bible with you, a digital one, a physical one, open it up. Turn it on to Numbers. We will look at a few passages in Numbers chapters 1 through 21 as we follow the storyline there. Now, to begin, if you remember in Exodus, the Israelites, the descendants of Abraham, were slaves in Egypt. That's where the book of Exodus begins. And God announced that he was going to rescue them from their slavery, and he chose the man Moses as the individual that he was going to use to bring them out of their slavery. And when we get to Exodus 19, God, working through Moses, has brought the Israelites out of their slavery and through the wilderness on the Sinai Peninsula to Mount Sinai. And at Exodus 19, God appears to the nation and he enters into a covenant relationship with them. In Exodus 19 through the end of Exodus, Exodus chapter 40, God is giving instructions to the nation that feature primarily instructions for building a tabernacle, a tent that God would live in, a tent that would be in the midst of the nation, a holy space that he could inhabit. Leviticus narrates the expectations, the rituals, the practices that God wanted the Israelites to perform that would make them a holy people and allow God's holy presence to remain in their midst. And when we get to the book of Numbers, God begins by organizing the nation in preparation for leaving Mount Sinai to travel to the land of Canaan, the land that he had promised to give them. In the first 10 chapters of Numbers, we read about God's organization of the nation, and he organized them in three concentric rings. In the centermost ring, we find the tabernacle. And the tabernacle was God's dwelling place. It was a holy space that he inhabited in the midst of the nation. And God allowed only Moses and Aaron and Aaron's sons access to the tabernacle. Aaron and his sons were appointed by God to be his priests serving him in that holy space. And the tabernacle was to be at the center of the nation. The second ring around the tabernacle was occupied by the Levites. The Levites were given the responsibility of protecting the holy space of the tabernacle and maintaining the holy space of the tabernacle. And then the third ring that went around the ring of the Levites was occupied by all of the rest of the Israelite tribes. God organized them around the tabernacle with the tabernacle at the very center. This was how God organized the nation in the first 10 chapters of Numbers. It was a deliberate organization in which he occupied the center to remind the entire nation that they were to revolve every aspect of their life around him. And after he organized the nation, in Numbers chapter 10 and verse 11, he gave the order for the nation to begin its journey from Mount Sinai to the land of Canaan. They had been camped at the mountain for a year. From Exodus 19 up till Numbers 10, we have a year's worth of time recorded. And they begin to make their journey across the wilderness towards the borders of Canaan. And there are a few mishaps as they make their journey, ominous mishaps that signal for us as readers the kinds of things we would encounter when they finally arrive at the border of the Promised Land. And when the nation arrived at the border of that land, beginning in Numbers chapter 13, we read about a series of three rebellions that move through each of those rings of the nation. Beginning at the outermost ring and working towards the center, we read about the nation's failures. For example, the first rebellion that deals with all of the Israelite tribes, the outer ring, the first rebellion happened in Numbers chapter 13 and chapter 14. When they arrived at the border of the Promised Land, they chose one representative from each of the 12 tribes to go and spy out the land that God had promised to give them. And you might remember in Numbers 13, at the end of the chapter, the spies return, and 10 of the 12 spies gave a bad report. Yes, they said the land is good, the land is fertile, the land is amazing, but we could never take it because the people there are more numerous than us, they're stronger than us, they're bigger than us. It will never happen. And the people believed the bad report of those 10 spies. And chapter 14 begins with the people lamenting about their situation as they perceived it. The people in Numbers chapter 14 and verse 2 grumbled against Moses and Aaron. And they said, "Would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would that we had died in the wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? Our wives and our little ones will become a prey. Would it not be better for us to go back to Egypt?" And so they decided they were going to reject Moses and Aaron's leadership and choose new leaders who would take them back to Egypt to be slaves again. And when this rebellion happened, God told Moses that he was going to disown the people, that he was going to destroy them and disinherit them from his promises. And beginning in verse 13 of that chapter, Moses interceded on the people's behalf, but God still issued a punishment, and it's a severe punishment. Listen to what God told them in Exodus or in Numbers 14 and verse 28. He told Moses to say to the people, "As I live, declares the Lord, what you have said in my hearing, I will do to you." Now remember, at the beginning of chapter 14, they said it'd be better to die in the wilderness than go into that land. So God, later in the chapter, says, "I'm going to give you what you asked for." Verse 29, "Your dead bodies shall fall in this wilderness, and all of your number listed in the census from 20 years old and upward who have grumbled against me, not one shall come into the land where I swore that I would make you dwell, except Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, the son of Nun." Those were the two spies who brought a good report. This is rebellion number one. The tribes rebelled against Moses and Aaron, God's appointed leaders. The tribes rebelled against God. They tried to go back to Egypt. And God responded severely to their rebellion, announcing that they would die in the wilderness. The second rebellion has to do with the Levites. If you remember, the Levites made up that inner ring, the second ring. In Numbers 16, we read about the response of an individual named Korah. He was one of the Levites. And he responded to Moses' message from God that the Israelites are going to die in the wilderness. He was not happy with the message that Moses brought. And so Korah, along with a few other people, Dathan and Abiram in Numbers 16, verse 1, come to Moses and Aaron, and they issue a complaint. In Numbers 16 and verse 3, they said to Moses and Aaron, "You have gone too far, for all in the congregation are holy, every one of them, and the Lord is among them. Why then do you exalt yourselves above the assembly of the Lord?" A little bit later, in verse 12 and 13 and 14, they accused Moses and Aaron as the reason why they didn't get into the land. "It's your fault that we didn't get in. You didn't do your job." This was an amplified rebellion of the people's rebellion in 13 and 14. Now it's a rebellion among those given a special place and position by God. It's a rebellion among the Levites. And God responded in an even more severe way to the rebellion of these individuals. Notice in verse 31, after Moses announced God's judgment against these three leaders of the rebellion, we're told that after Moses finished speaking all these words, the ground under them split apart, and the earth opened its mouth and swallowed them up with their households and all the people who belonged to Korah and all their goods. So they and all that belonged to them went down alive into Sheol, and the earth closed over them, and they perished from the midst of the assembly. It's a shockingly severe punishment for their rebellion that amplifies the severity of the punishment God issued to the first rebellion in chapters 13 and 14. But that still leaves one more rebellion. Now we're going to jump to Numbers chapter 20. The third rebellion involves Moses and Aaron, those privileged to occupy the very center of the ring that was part of the way that God organized the nation. Moses and Aaron, who had access to God's holy tabernacle, who had access to his presence. Numbers chapter 20, beginning verse 2, the people complain that they don't have any water. And so God gives directions to Moses and Aaron about how they're to handle the situation. And when we get to verse 10, we find that in frustration because of the way the people were behaving, Moses and Aaron did not follow God's directions. And their failure to follow God's directions resulted in God approaching them and bringing this message to them. Verse 12, "The Lord said to Moses and Aaron, 'Because you did not believe in me to uphold me as holy in the eyes of the people of Israel, therefore you shall not bring this assembly into the land that I have given them.'" Now, in each of the three, or in each of the two rebellions up to this third one, God responded with increasingly more severe punishments. And now, with the rebellion of Aaron and Moses, we find that rebellion has moved through the entirety of the nation. All three rings of the way God organized the nation have been invaded, infected by rebellion. And as readers, we're prepared for a severe response from God. We're primed for some escalated judgment, as we saw a judgment escalating from rebellion 1 to rebellion 2. But notice how God responds in chapter 21. In chapter 21, beginning of verse 1, we read, "When the Canaanite, the king of Arad, who lived in the Negev, heard that Israel was coming by the way of Ethyrim, he fought against Israel and took some of them captive. And Israel vowed a vow to the Lord and said, 'If you will indeed give this people into my hand, then I will devote their cities to destruction.' And the Lord heeded the voice of Israel and gave over the Canaanites, and they devoted them and their cities to destruction. So the name of the place was called Hormah." It might sound like a discardable bit of historical trivia, a small incident in the larger narrative of Israel's story. But it's actually insight into the undeserved and generous grace of God. Notice, go back a few chapters. Go back to Numbers chapter 14. In Numbers chapter 14, if you remember, The Israelites had sent spies across to check out the land when they first arrived. The spies brought back a bad report, and the people complained. They said, "We would have rather died in the wilderness than go over." And when Moses brought God's message that that's what you're going to get, I'm going to give you what you've asked for, that wasn't the end of that scene. After Moses brought this message to the people then began weeping and mourning the response that they received from God. And so they decided they were going to go take the land as God had instructed. And Moses warned them, it's past that point. Don't go. But they still went anyway. And notice, in beginning in verse 39, they didn't listen to the words of Moses. And Moses warned them in verse 42, do not go up. The Lord is not among you. But they went anyway. And because God was not with them, the people that they went to fight against, the inhabitants of the land, the Amalek and the Canaanites, in verse 45, came down from the hills and defeated them and pursued them even to Hormah. The place that God gave them victory in chapter 21 was the location of their previous defeat as punishment for their rebellion. At a place loaded with significance, God showed them mercy and grace. He extended benevolence to them at the place that was a reminder of their failure. He gave them victory in a place of rebellion and defeat. And this unexpected grace that God showed to Israel is not a unique story in the Bible. It's one story in a Bible full of stories of God giving people grace. Consider, for example, Genesis chapter 12. We read from Genesis 3 through chapter 11 about humanity's spreading rebellion against God. It got to a point in Genesis 6 where the whole world was devoted to sin, and so God destroyed the world and started over, using Noah to fund a new creation. But we find when we get to chapter 11 that the creation has resorted back to its ways that led to the flood in Genesis chapter 6. And how did God respond to humanity's renewed sin? Genesis 12, verses 1, 2, and 3. He responded with a promise to bless the whole world. He responded with grace and mercy to a world in rebellion. We find that same message is picked up by Paul. For example, in Romans chapter 3 and verse 23, Paul writes that everyone has sinned. Everyone has fallen short. Everyone has rebelled against God's will. And God's response, Romans 6 and verse 23, is to offer the free gift of eternal life through Christ Jesus. The God that we read about in the Bible is a God characterized by mercy and grace. And the stories in the Bible remind us of his desire and willingness and readiness to extend that to undeserving people. And that's why we should be thankful people, because we are beneficiaries of the goodness and the graciousness of our God. Now, we understand that God takes sin very seriously. But it's important we recognize that part of his very serious response is to extend undeserved and unexpected grace. And that's part of the portrait God reveals about himself in Scripture. In the Bible, God shows that he is a God, yes, who pursues justice, but does it in a way where it's counterbalanced by overwhelming grace and mercy. We read that, for example, in God's description of his identity in Exodus 34, verses 5 and 6 and 7. It's the reason he sent Jesus, John 3, 16, 17, not to condemn the world, but to save the world. God takes no pleasure in the death of the wicked, Ezekiel talked about in Ezekiel 18, verses 1 through 32. Because our God that we read about in the Bible is a God who desires everyone to be saved, as Paul writes in 1 Timothy chapter 2. And as we reflect on that identity of God, as our God as a God marked by grace that he extends readily and generously to people, it reminds us of the kind of people we should be. Because of the grace that God extends, we should be people who are thankful to him. Thankful for the grace that he shows to us, but our thankfulness for God's grace ought to motivate us to offer similar, undeserved, and unexpected grace to everyone around us. We should be as ready and generous with our grace towards others as God is towards us. And as we behave like him, as we extend that grace to those around us, they will have an opportunity to encounter the goodness of our God through our behavior, to see something about his reality and sovereignty and grace through the way that he has changed our response to them, our response to the world around us. So our thankfulness is not merely something that extends from our lives upward, but it also extends outward to contact the lives of everyone around us. Our thankfulness to God transforms our relationships with the people around us. And that's why we gather and worship, because God is deserving of our praise. And it's a way for us to remind ourselves of his goodness and his sovereignty, and a way to remind ourselves of how we are to behave in this world because of who he is. And for us, the fullest expression of God's grace is in Jesus. It's in Jesus that we both understand the reality of our own failures, our own selfishness that motivates us to do what we want rather than what God wants. The Bible calls that sin. But it's also in Jesus that we have a chance to become somebody different, a chance to become a new person. Our baptism gives us a new identity. Symbolically, as we reenact Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, our baptism gives us a new identity, a chance to become somebody whose life is defined by the mercy and the grace of our God. But that carries with it the expectation that we live different lives, that we're transformed by our encounter with God's grace. This morning, if we can help you, if we can support you, if we can encourage you in any way, we are a family united by Jesus, and we will do that. Most importantly, if this morning you need to petition God's grace in your life, his mercy and his forgiveness for you, this is a chance you can do that. As a family, as we rally around him, as a family, we can rally and support one another and be assured of the grace of our God coming into our lives. If you have a need this morning, you can let it be known right now as we